Hey guys, welcome to this lesson. In this lesson, I'm going to cover the AWS Identity and Access Management Service known as IAM, or also sometimes called IAM. So IAM is a really important service to understand because it's the service that we use for authentication and authorization. So here we have an AWS account with AWS IAM. Of course, there's different ways that we can manage AWS. We've got the console, we've got the command line interface and the API through SDKs. So through IAM, we can create things like users and roles. We can use federated users and we can enable authentication for applications as well. Now, all IAM principles must be authenticated to send requests. In other words, to send any kind of API request to AWS. A principal is a person or application that makes a request for an action, that's an API action or operation, on an AWS resource. Now, firstly, we have authentication, so that's essentially proving that you are who you say you are, for example, by supplying a password. Then we need authorization. Authorization is where we either are allowed or denied access to resources. And here we have policies like identity-based policies and resource-based policies, which define what we are allowed to do. So first, through authentication, we prove we are who we say we are. Then AWS determines what we are allowed to actually do. For example, performing API actions like run instances on EC2, that launches a virtual server. Get bucket retrieves information about buckets, and create user means to create a user in IAM. So the API actions are authorized on the AWS resources. A few of the core components of IAM are users, user groups, roles, and policies. User groups are used for adding users and then applying permissions policies. So we have the user account. You can log in with a user account. We have the policy that determines what users are allowed to do, what API actions are they allowed to take in the account or on a specific resource. And so the way that we apply these policies to multiple users is by attaching them to a user group. So if we have several people who have a common job role, we can attach a policy that provides the permissions they need to do their job, put all those users in the group, and now we only have one permissions policy to manage. So the user will gain the permissions applied to the group through the policy. These are called identity-based policies. They get applied to users, groups, and roles. And roles are used for delegation, and they are assumed. We'll talk a bit more about that later, but essentially what's happening here is a role is an identity which has permissions assigned to it via a policy, and then you can assume the role and take on whatever those permissions are. It's kind of like putting that hat on. That's why it's a picture of a hat. You might put a hat on for your development role and take on the development permissions. Maybe then you're going to do a SysOps role. You take off your development hat, put on the role hat for development, and you become a developer. So that's what a role is. We'll look at that more a bit later on. Now, the policies define the permissions for the identities or resources they are associated with. Let's look at IAM users in a bit more detail. When you created your account, you supplied an email address and that created the root user account. And as I've mentioned before, the root user has full permissions and you can't restrict most of those permissions. So it's a best practice not to use that account. What you should do is set a very strong password and enable multi-factor authentication. Then we're going to create user accounts. You can create up to 5,000 individual user accounts, and those user accounts will have no permissions by default. That's a really important point to remember. So if you create a user account, that user can log in if you enable management console access, but they can't do anything at all unless you specifically apply permissions to them. So here we have a user, we've got Andrea. Now Andrea, when she logs in, we'll use her friendly name. The friendly name is just a simple text string. In this case, it's actually her name, Andrea. So you can log in very simply with Andrea and then a password. Now, there's actually, for every resource in AWS, there's an Amazon resource name. Okay, you can see that here. Now, the text in red is the account number. We can see a little bit, it's an ARN, so it's an Amazon resource name. It's an AWS resource. It's an IAM resource. This is the account number. We know that this type of resource is a user, and then the friendly name is Andrea. So that's a unique identifier for that resource within AWS. Now, Andrea can log in via these different mechanisms. We've got the management console for which you use a username and password and potentially multi-factor authentication. And then for the command line interface and the API, we can use access keys. So let's move on to user groups. Great thing about user groups is it helps us from a management perspective. Here, we've got the admin group, the development group, and the operations group. We can add our users in. Some users might be in multiple groups. And the groups are then used to apply permissions. Okay, so now we can take a permissions policy that's relevant to those specific groups of users and apply it to the group. And those users will automatically inherit those permissions. Now, if a user is in multiple groups, they will gain multiple sets of permissions and they are combined together. So the user will gain the permissions applied to the group through the permissions policy. For authentication methods, we can use a username and password with a multi-factor authentication token for that extra factor of security. We can use that mechanism for connecting to the management console using an IAM account. So here, John is authenticated and can perform operations through the console. Now, the other ways are the command line interface and the API. For this, we need to gain some credentials. There's a couple of ways of doing this. One is by generating something called an access key ID and a secret access key. It's kind of like a username and password. And these can be used via the CLI and the API to authenticate to the AWS API. And we can use something called the AWS Security Token Service to generate short-term credentials as well. So access keys are used for programmatic access. I'll just finish this lesson by summarizing the differences between the root user and an IAM user. So remember that the root user is the one in which you log in with the email address that you used when you created the account. And it has full access and is unrestricted. Also difficult to restrict. Some permissions cannot be restricted for the root user account. There are some actions which you need the root user to perform, but mostly, once we've got our account up and running, we don't need it, so we can lock it away and not use that account. And then we have our IAM user, which has a friendly name, and when we log in using this user account, we will supply either the alias for the account or the account ID itself. And the permissions assigned to an IAM user come through permissions policies. If there's no permissions policies applied to this user directly or via any groups that the user is a member of, then they won't have any permissions. So you have to enable permissions by assigning policies either directly or usually preferably through a user group instead.